Good evening, everyone. A very, very warm welcome to you all at the sixth building talk at Collect 2021, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. I'm Rosie Greenies, I'm Executive Director of the Crafts Council. Launched in 2004 by the Crafts Council, Collect is the leading art fair for contemporary craft, and it's been instrumental in developing and growing the market for collecting. Maintaining the open-hearted nature of the fair, and at a time when we just sadly can't all come together at the fair's home at Somerset House in London, it gives me very great pleasure to welcome you to the online version of Collect for 2021. This year, we have 32 carefully selected international galleries representing almost 400 artists spanning some 35 nations. The exceptional works for sale at Collect can be viewed at the online art platform artsy.net, and the link will be displayed at the end of the talk for you to visit and enjoy. As part of Collect, we're hosting a series of talks that explore craft through the objects, makers and gallerists exhibiting. This year, the Fielding Talk is presented as part of Collect. This talk was established by the Crafts Council in memory of the writer and curator Amanda Fielding, who sadly died in 2012. Amanda Fielding curated the Crafts Council's contemporary craft collection, and over 17 years, she built a fantastic range of work, developing and nurturing makers of that time. This talk series was established to celebrate making through the voice of the maker and to recognise Amanda's passion and knowledge for the sector through the voices and experiences of the most exciting and innovative makers in applied art and craft. The Fielding talk takes its lead from her belief that extremely high levels of knowledge of and skill in making and materials are at the heart of contemporary practice. Over the past years, we've had a fantastic range of speakers for this talk, fashioning the format each time to suit the maker. Julian Stair gave a keynote lecture reflecting on the development of his extraordinary Quietus exhibition. Jeweller David Poston spoke as one of the participating makers in the First Decade project, which charted the first 10 years of the Crafts Council's collection and its makers. The textile artist Anne Sutton was in conversation with curator Jill Headley. And most recently, Simone ten Hompel took us on an inspiring journey of her work as a silversmith and metal worker. In 2020, to tie in with the opening of our new gallery space, we had invited Magdalene Odundo. But of course, and sadly, a pandemic got in the way. So instead, we're hosting the Fielding Talk as part of Collect, the Crafts Council's International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. And we're better placed to host this talk, where makers, artists, galleries, collectors and craft enthusiasts gather together in a mutual love of craft and making at its highest level. The brief for the Fielding Talk is quite simply for a maker to speak about their practice, to explore a particular moment or working towards that moment, such as a key exhibition or body of work, or perhaps a wider subject of their choice. When we first invited Magdalene to give the Fielding talk, she spoke about the significance of the Stunning Journey of Things exhibition shown at the Hepworth Gallery in Wakefield and the Sainsbury Centre in Norwich, both in the UK, and also an earlier show in the US. She will be using those moments to frame a discussion about the development of her practice and inspirations to her work. Magdalene Odundo, OBE, DBE, is an internationally respected ceramic artist. She was born in Kenya and moved to the UK in 1971, where she then studied at Farnham College and the Royal College of Art. Magdalene was appointed Officer of the Order of the British Empire for services to arts in the 2008 birthday honours, and Dame Commander of the Order of the British Empire in the 2020 New Year Honours for Services to Art and Arts Education. As an African British artist, Odundo's interweaving of references to historical and contemporary making practices from different cultures has led her to an exploration of her diasporic identity and the charged role that objects play in intercultural relationships. This, I think, was clearly evident in her exhibition Journey of Things, which I had the great pleasure to see. It was rich, textured, and expansive, both visually and conceptually. Tonight, we will hear more about her interest, inspiration, and journey into making, which has taken her through Europe, Asia, Central America, and Eastern Africa. I am a great fan and admirer of Magdalene's, so I know this talk will be a treat, but even more so because I'm very delighted that she will be in conversation with Dr. Gus Casely-Hayford, OBE. Gus is an internationally renowned museum director, cultural historian, writer and broadcaster. He was appointed the inaugural director of V&A East in November 2019. Gus is also a columnist for the Crafts Council's Crafts magazine. And if you're a subscriber or reader, you will have read his column on Magdalena in our January-February issue this year. So you will know he is eminently suited to the task of talking to Magdalene about her work. Magdalene and Gus will be in conversation for 35 to 40 minutes, and then there'll be an opportunity for the audience to ask some questions. If you would like to do so, please click on the Q&A icon, which is at the bottom of your screen, and you can do this at any point during the event. My colleague, Annabelle Campbell, Head of Exhibitions and Collections at the Crafts Council, will then host the Q&A session. But first, I'd like to hand over to Gus. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rosie. And thank you all for joining us this evening, for everyone at the Crafts Council and the Collect team, and just for everyone, for all that you do to support this magnificent discipline that we all love. And I cannot think of a more fitting subject for the Fielding Lecture. I think Amanda would have been absolutely delighted, as am I, truly delighted to welcome Dame, Professor, Chancellor Magdalene Odundo, a great friend, a brilliant teacher, a towering advocate for the arts, a great exhibition maker, multiple prize winner, and recently and so deservedly ennobled, but also one of the greatest living ceramicist, someone who has made a huge contribution to one of the very oldest creative disciplines, creating thoughtful, beautiful, affecting works. And this is art that can leave you changed. And Magdalene, it's such a privilege to speak to you today. And what a time to be doing it. I mean, how are you before we start?
I am much better, thank you very much. And I too would love to pause and remember Amanda, because I knew her fairly well, and hope her daughter and husband are well. But she was very instrumental in the collection at the Crafts Council, which, you know, the most important thing is that she, when she visited us makers, she would make us feel very comfortable and very important. And she really is missed by many. So thank you for Crafts Council for inviting me to be part and parcel of celebrating Amanda and our new galleries as well.
And this is a kind of unusual time to be doing this, not just lockdown, COVID, but also this particular year. It's been an unusual year, hasn't it, in so many ways. Has any of that impacted you or your practice?
I think it has in some ways or not. I mean, one of the things is I've always worked from home. So it hasn't been in terms of studio, I didn't have to kind of, I didn't have to move my equipment. And that would have been something because I have a huge kiln on the premises. So in terms of working, it's been okay. It's been very, I felt terribly disorganized. I'm still disorganized just because everywhere else is and everybody else is. So I sort of, I think we all feel empathy about the situation that has occurred. But in terms of making, it's given me, in a funny way, the last year or so has given me time to heal and time to think of my health quite a bit. So I, you know, sort of, I'm grateful for that. And I have kept in touch with people long and wide.
Just that introduction that Rosie gave, and just a sense of the amount that you contribute to the sector, the different roles that that you take on. I mean, have you missed the interaction with other artists, with students, with friends? And because does all of that feed into your practice usually? And how have you felt over the course of this year where that hasn't necessarily been possible?
Oh, I think so. And thank you, Rosie. I feel like I should not even need to talk after that introduction. But yeah, no, I think missing. I think because I was so used, first of all, I was always very used to popping into the college because I live in Farnham and UCA Farnham is at my doorstep. And often when I go for a walk through the park, I just pop in to say hello to people there, but it's all cordoned off. You can't get there. And it does feel strange. It does, you know, sort of, I have had one or two visits. I think like, you know, sort of other people, I won't shout about it. We have broken the codes occasionally.
I think I dropped it actually, didn't I, at one point? I know. Probably
yeah, but yeah, it has been strange. I think what I've missed most is visiting, you know, sort of just being able to get into to visit museums and to go in and without having to be ushered around. That's been difficult.
It's also been a year of Black Lives Matters, of this sort of shift in race consciousness, of a kind of a deepening of awareness, you know, and not just kind of in the political sphere, but it's impacted everything, including culture. Is that something that has touched you, moved you, made you sort of reflect on things?
I think Black Lives Matter did impact on me in a reflective way, and sadly, I think it brought back memories of this image that is on the screen. These two images just remind me of the fact that I lived through a colonial period when Kenya was actually in the throes of the shift between, you know, sort of with people fighting for land. It started off as fighting for land. And I think there was an eeriness of this kind of continuation and resurfacing of that colonial impact, that bondage sort of atmosphere that one grew up in. And the legacy of colonialism, which actually is part and parcel of slavery, the slave trade, it has impacted so much on our lives and so much on Africa. What continues in post-colonial countries is a legacy of this racial divide and rule. That first image, that other image, shows you how people were rounded up, including some of my relatives, into these camps, and they were camps, and they're not very different from the camps that were in Europe during the Second World War. People were damaged by this. And you can see, you know, this, it reminded me of the kneeling, you know, sort of, you can see them being hounded and being rounded up. And we grew up in this environment. You couldn't, and it was an apartheid system that remains today. And then the next, the other slide can, you know, sort of shows you how successful that notion, that impact of colonialism, of divide and rule. It was not just racial. We had four classes of citizens. It was white, mixed or colored, as they call them, or half caste. Indian and Africans were at the bottom. And then with that, you had them dividing the nations, the different African, as they call them, tribes, which were big, big nations. And some of them were elevated to being askaris or soldiers, and they were rounding their own people. And this has, you know, left, you know, when people talk about tribalism and corruption and all that, you know, the fights that we had in Biafra, the fights we had in Mozambique, post-colonial, are all a legacy of this period. And so, you know, the movement coming, and when I came to Britain, of course, we had the Black Power movement, Angela Davis and all that, and we were all immersed in it. And it just doesn't seem to have changed. I think that's the saddest bit about it. So we are working as artists within an environment that just seems to be perpetuated.
Sorry, carry on, Magdalene.
I was going to say we may be materially a lot richer, but I think our souls are still broken.
Yes, but one of the ways in which we could potentially both reflect back on that pain, perhaps transcend some of the areas of difference, perhaps project forward into the possibility of real hope is through the arts, and it is through your sort of work which helps us to navigate these things in such beautiful ways. And I was just thinking about how I look at your work, and it has so many different layers of meaning and resonance that speak to me in so many ways in terms of thinking about that pain, but also thinking about the possibility of transcending it and of hope. And I just wondered, how did you begin? How did you get started on this journey? Because your work is both so different, but also it feels so familiar. It links to so many things that I know and feel so close to.
I think the word familiarity is a great one, because I think, you know, sort of, I love the fact that work, you know, my work is familiar, and my work does not need a great explanation. I'm not sure how I started now, and I'm, you know, sort of thinking about it. I think I always had, I went to schools where, you know, sort of art or crafts were being encouraged, and I always was engaged in that. I think the switch from commercial art into working with clay, I think was a very a great step for me. It was something that I had never done. I'd never touched clay, and I don't think crafts was encouraged very much in colonial days at school. So discovering it when I was doing my foundation at Cambridge was a really life-forming and life-changing event for me.
And so much of the writing about your work, it begins with descriptions about technique, and that is completely understandable because your work is utterly magical. And I just am obsessed with trying to sort of unravel how these gorgeous things are made, but they are so complete that it is difficult to actually kind of decipher. I mean, could you give us a sense of method and process?
Well, as you know, in many societies, particularly in traditional societies, a potter is always considered very a magician to be feared in many circumstances.
I understand that.
So I think I ended up, you know, falling into the right métier, as it were. The making itself is very simple. I combine various techniques. I actually learned how to coil in Abuja in Nigeria, and it's a particular at the starting point is particularly gwari in its method of working, where you start with a lump of clay and you pull the clay out, or you sculpt the clay out and build wall. It's almost like building a house with, you know, with bricks. You move the clay from inside and you sort of pile it onto the walls. And when it gets the height you want, then you start shaping it. It's kind of very difficult, but at the same time, it's actually very close to a very slow way of Japanese or Korean throwing, where they throw with a hand moved wheel rather than a momentum wheel. So it combines that. It's more like closer to, it's almost like the first invention of throwing, and then, you know, sort of traditionally, even when people are making large pieces, they will then add a coil on and throw it again. And then once I've got the shape, when the clay is a little bit stiffer, that's when I actually start making the work. And I start change, you know, sort of from the shoulder on, start actually making it into the work that it's going to be. And much of my time, much of the working process is done standing up.
And the finishes that, because you're talking about structure but and form, but so much of what I adore about your work is these sort of magical finishes that are, you know, metallic, and they are kind of the sort of glazes and the slips are kind of coming through each other, and it is utterly magical. I mean, how do you achieve that, and how have you developed those techniques?
A lot of patience. I think I find it very difficult to describe, because it's, you know, sort of the way I work is very tactile. I'm working very close to the piece. I'm working, you know, I don't work on a high table. So all the time I'm actually embracing the work. It's almost like cradling a child. And then, you know, when the pieces are ready, when I've finished all the structure and building, I then take the piece in my lap or on the banding wheel, and I'm very close to it, and I will polish and burnish and work my way through getting the surface that I want. And basically the technique is to do with clay all the time, because I then apply a thin coating of slip, and then that is burnished afterwards again. But what the thing that actually finishes my work is the firings. And for somebody who really dislikes firings, I cannot avoid but fire the work, because without the firings, especially the secondary firings, where I used to actually put all the work maybe in a saga to begin with, but I find it easier to actually I now have an electric kiln, so I'll have all the work in a first firing where they'll all be terracotta color, and then they go into a saga firing. And sometimes the saga firing doesn't work the first time, so it will be, you know, sort of, I could actually fire the piece about 5 times. And it's often very difficult to actually get galleries or museums to understand that I cannot actually tell them what the work is going to be until it's achieved that final firing.
I find that fascinating, that you're in a kind of dialogue, a dance with the pieces, and that you can't always be certain of the way in which they are going to move, of how they're going to turn out. And it's a negotiation from the way that you describe it, and that there is something of this thing coming to life and actually making its own way and becoming its own thing.
And I think most people who work on individual work, and one might call it sculptures, you know, sort of being a sculptor or being a weaver or a craftsperson. I think when you're working so close to the work, you are dancing with it. You are actually having a dialogue with it. And they become kind of like they adopt this persona themselves. Each piece you make transforms itself into something else. They may en masse look similar, but as you get close to them, they're like having 10 children in your house. They all have their own characters, because no two pieces ever end up the same for me.
But when you're playing, you're engaged in this negotiation, which is both technical and it's intellectual, but there's also a component of it which is about a knowledge of art history, of wider context, of heritage. Because I look at your work and I find it as a kind of, it's like a compass. It offers me a way of navigating geography and history, and a range of really kind of complex issues that feel very, very much kind of part of what is happening today. I mean, when you're thinking, you're actually sort of building a pot, are you thinking about some of those issues and the sorts of ways in which the form might resonate and might connect and might sort of have associations that the viewer might also connect to? Are you thinking about art history? Are you thinking about all the different ways in which this might sort of build dialogues for the viewer?
I think I do, and I think much, and the important aspect is conceptually what I'm thinking of imbuing in that particular piece of work. This piece that we're looking at present was a piece that really gave me a lot of palaver, as I say, and in the end, you know, it just needed that extra hook, and it needed that extra, the ribs were showing themselves, because it was kind of angry. And and when I actually exhibited that work for the first time in Holland at Sitogenbosch, the person who wrote the text in the catalog came with his wife, who was literally expecting to have the baby the next day, and they left the exhibition, and I was told she kept saying to me, oh, that piece is making her sick. She was feeling pain. But it's and I do want people to get whatever they want within that piece, because ceramic affords us this wonderful opportunity to have a vessel, an inside and outside. And ceramics is really human. It just displays and gives you that chance to actually be mischievous, but also be very careful with it. So I think, I do think about what I want to imbue in the work. And the other two pieces, I don't know whether we can get back to the two pieces, the tall pieces. Those when I was making those, it was, I think it just happened during the anniversary of my dad. My dad died in 1958, and it was like, for me, these were kind of remembering the rites of passage of my parents, because I had to, we were very young, we had to attend both, and they became pieces that I actually made to celebrate their lives. And so for me, they reminded me very much of the vigangos of made by a group in at the coast of Kenya where I grew up, where every X amount of years you make sculpture to commemorate the lives of those who went before, but you don't actually make portraits of them. You imbue them in what it is they were as people, the generosity they had, the spirit they have. So in this, I think I was thinking of them really sending that spirit to us, to me and my siblings. So there are things like that that will come in, but you know, sort of they don't appear in title, because for me, a vessel is a vessel, a pot is a pot. You can't do, whether it's got appendages or with sculptural or whatever, ultimately it has to have, for me, it has to be a vessel. So it has to contain and uncontain, whether it's of the mind, of the body, or of liquid or anything like that.
That is so beautiful, Magdalene, really poetic. And I sadly missed, I was away in the US where I was working, but I missed that amazing exhibition at the Hepworth, The Journey of Things, which in which you brought together 50 of your works alongside work from a variety of different sources. Could you tell me a little bit about the development of that particular project, that amazing exhibition?
It was indeed an amazing project brought together by three wonderful young curators, Andrew Bonacina, Hilary Faux, and Tanya Moore, worked alongside Anthony, my representative, and the host places. But I really can't claim any brain power. It really is left to them. It is
no. You're just being.
I kind
you
of.
You are always so modest, Matt. You can't get away with that with me.
I ended up being on stage after they came up with the thoughts behind it. And it started off with, I think, Andrew and the Wakefield Hepworth Gallery had started with Jonathan Anderson doing these thematic projects where they invite people to actually go through their collection and respond to the collection, which is something that I love doing. And then they did all the work of getting the work. But it just gave me the opportunity to reflect back, to think back as to that question you asked me, how and where I came from. So this aspect of research and study that one had to conduct because you were teaching, you had to kind of be at the moment with your students. So you had to kind of try to have a trick above them. It enabled me to tap on those knowledges, but it also enabled me to look at the way the work had developed and where the sources had come from. I went through State Murray, you know, sort of traditional metal pieces, Hans Koper, although I never was taught by him, and these bronzes that we're looking at. So it was very expansive, and I was kind of careful in the work that I selected, because I wanted it to really have informed the work that I made. So of the contemporary people I had, people like Julian Stair, had Elena Tsui and Yinka Shana Barry, because of the different routes they had taken. Julian had worked with death and what it means. And many of the pieces, as I say, said, have this ceremony, this rite of passage that I was immersed in as a child, but also that I'm fascinated by the notion of ancestral spirits, as you know, in Africa, and the living is a very important, but a very real and meaningful thing, a notion rather, and idea. So, you know, sort of people don't just die, they transit to the other world, because they physically die, but their souls are still there.
Wow.
And then I had, you know, sort of at Hepworth, I had a glass installation that was called Metamorphosis and Transformation, which was also an installation. And at the Sainsbury Center, I had this piece, Transition 2, which is a site-specific piece. But my intention is that it captures the moment of that is important in the region that I exhibit here. It worked as the murmurations of Stirlings, because in Norfolk and in that part of the world, you see it very clearly because the land is flat. But the ideas really came. We worked with a mood board where Andrew and Hillary and I were looking at images of objects from the other collections and where they actually had been mentioned during all the lectures or in my sketchbook. And you know, how it ended up isn't really to do with me. Farshid Msavi was the designer for the Hepworth Gallery, and David Ajay was associates were the designer for the Sainsbury collection, for the Sainsbury exhibition. So I was very fortunate and very privileged to work with a host of people who wanted it to happen and really understood what I wanted.
Well, I having read about it and seen amazing images of it, I get a sense that, I mean, you describe it as an exploration of how and where, but it's also an exploration, like so much of your work, of why. It's about, it gets to a kind of an existential truth which underpins and connects us to art, but also connects so much great art. And we're going to open up to questions in a moment. So if you have questions, please do put them into the chat bar. But I'm just fascinated by that thing that you do, which is particularly in times like these, when there has been so much loss and so much questioning, and the way in which your work speaks across time and across difference and brings us all together. And I'm just, you know, I'm fascinated to hear, could you tell us about some of your present projects and some of the things that you're planning to do?
I just had an exhibition actually that was paired with Brancusi images with Michael Hugh Williams, that one, and COVID didn't allow me to get there, but I know that those who visited it there loved it. But I've also been working, and I don't have an image, I've been working with Jonathan Anderson on with some of my prints, which have been knitted and been fabricated into blankets. And that's been a journey that's been very, very interesting, pairing, you know, working with an initiative that is being initiated by a fashion designer, looking at life, looking at what it is to be a person, to be grounded, to have issues with how other people perceive you, not having limbs, not having, you know, sort of, it's been a two-dimensional project for me, but amazing project. And then I'm working for several shows in the next 3 or 4 years. I'm working for one in London, or rather New York, with Salon 94 for May. But they, you know, have exhibitions at Hapton. Another good project that I have is the one I mentioned earlier when we were talking to trustees, which is the fact that Farnham has been designated World Craft Town. And there are a lot of activities that are going to emerge. They've been put to bed a bit because of COVID, but that with collaboration with the University Craft Studies Center at Farnham, the Ashgate, the Maltings particularly, will be very interesting to see how that flourishes into community projects. But it is celebrating all the craft activities that go on in Farnham. So there are projects.
Gosh, it's so exciting. And as we come out of lockdown, it's so wonderful to think of all of that wonderful Magdalene Odundo work out there for us to discover. So exciting. If there are questions now, we're going to be opening up, because it'd be wonderful to hear from you. Annabelle, you're going to help us to navigate this period.
I am, just bear with me. hang on. Sorry, just bear with me. My full screen's just disappeared.
I mean, Magdalene, while we're waiting, I mean, are there artists, are there cultural phenomena that you enjoy, that you feel that really sort of are resonating with you and your practice?
You know, what I'm really excited about is all the emerging artists coming out of everywhere, but particularly from Africa.
Yeah.
There is so much. I mean, when I was last in Kenya, I was absolutely amazed at how innovative and how sort of clever all the young people were, and they were managing to work in all sorts. Some of them had fantastic studios, but some of them were working in some of the word shanty, which I hate to use, in very, very crowded and deprived areas. South Africa has amazing young talent coming out, but so has Britain. I mean, you know,
lots of questions coming in. So,
Hi, can you hear me now? Sorry about that. We've got so many questions. And first of all, very quickly, Magdalene, Gus, what a privilege to hear you talk together. Such a personal, engaging, kind of really privileged to kind of that you let us into that. So thank you. So lots and lots of questions. We've got about just under 10 minutes. So I'm going to start with trying to collate some of the themes. Is that there's several people have asked about, you talk about vessels and you work with the kind of vessel form, and you talk about pots being pots. But have you ever thought about moving into pure sculpture? You know, your work, you talked about, like I said, the pots, but your work is so sculptural, its forms. Have you ever been tempted to actually focus on the sculpture over the vessel?
I actually don't see any difference between sculpture and the work that I make. Sculpture is built Either you carve or you build in. And the difference between stone carving and pottery is that a stone carver will want to carve out, or, you know, sort of, where a potter works, a vessel comes naturally. But, you know, if you look at classical ceramics or classical work in clay, I think I'd rather kind of dwell on work in clay rather than sculpture and a vessel or pot, because a number of the pieces that you find in traditional Africa have got, you know, armatures and figures and snakes and whatever it is. They are sculptural, if you want. They're made to go on a grave, or they're made to be part of a healing process. And, you know, sort of, if we had time, I would show you pieces that to do with, you know, embodiment and to do with, you know, sort of form. I think for me, if we took the word out of the word vessel and sculpture and concentrated on form, perhaps it would make sense, because form then can be formed in any material.
Yeah. And is the inside of the work as important as the outside? So that's something when you touched on, we've had so many questions about how you create those magical surfaces and glazes, and how, you know, what's the relationship for you as you're making between the inside and the outside, and how you treat those surfaces?
I think the inside is the most important in my work. If the inside isn't well made, the outside will not correspond to that.
Right.
And I have this dreadful fear of pieces breaking and then people finding out that I really messed up inside and just covered it by closing it in. So it's, you know, it emanates from the fact that the inside contains, and the inside is the most important, because it is the womb that contains all my thoughts and imagination. It is the healer's storage place. It's what breathes out the outside. Oh. And then, you know, so it is important to make. I think if you have a good inside, if you have a good bowl, the inside of the bowl matters, and you caress the outside in correspondence to what is contained in the bowl. So I think it matters.
And also, we've also had a lot of questions asking about, when you start to make a piece, do you have a sense of how it's going to develop and what the end result is going to be? Or is that process, is it really just evolving through you talk about kind of caressing the clay and working with it. You know, what is that process of starting with your clay and the end result? How much
I start with intention, and if anybody had seen the journey of things, a number of my sketchbooks and sketches were there. So I do enjoy actually doodling, but also coming up with concepts and ideas of what the outside will be.
Right.
And then, you know, forming the inside to fit the outline that I have made on the page. But they are very carefully, and I have deliberately worked with very, very few shapes and few forms, all to do with arresting tempo, arresting stances, arresting, you know, sort of gestures. Because I want to keep improving, and I just keep hoping that one day I will really have in one piece of work everything that I have aspired for all these years. It's like aiming to make the best bowl that you've ever made? or best teapot? I mean, I don't make teapots because I find teapots very difficult to make. Yeah. But for a good teapot to pour, the inside has to be absolutely perfect.
I think your work feels like perfection to a lot of people who look at it. You might not yourself.
I wish.
I would agree with that.
I've got two final questions. I think we can just squeeze in. So also had many questions about the work in glass, and a question specifically about your experience of working with glass and what you felt the differences were, kind of particularly with the intimacy of working with clay as a material, and the intimacy of working with the blown glass is obviously quite different when working in a hot glass studio. And how did you kind of, as a maker, kind of negotiate those different relationships between your materials?
I think once I got I really got to understand glass blowers, I think in around 1997, I was invited to go and work at Navibor in the Czech Republic. And I worked with people there, but it's at Tacoma, the Museum of Glass, that I realized how different sort of glass blowers worked as opposed to potters, even in industry, because glass blowing is a little bit like an opera or a theatrical performance. Mm. They have, you know, gaffers and they have blowers and they have people who just sit there and turn the metal, and they dart from one place to the other. But what was interesting is that I came to them with a sketchbook full of ideas, and they said to me, oh, just draw it on the floor, because they understand it immediately. And I think it's the immediacy of glass blowing particularly. I think kiln glass is different, but glass blowing is that these people are absolutely amazing. They're specialists. They can actually read your mind, and they can blow something for you which is blown in half an hour, and then next day you get it out. Well, in ceramics, I think you'd be very lucky, as any of you have watched Pottery Throwdown and so how things come out broken if you force them. But with glass, and also I like the fact that with glass, you can recycle glass, especially clear glass, and you can continue remaking work. But and the repetition, the ability to have made transition and metamorphosis and transformation, is the fact that they can immediately repeat those processes, whereas with ceramics, unless you do slip casting or mold making, you don't get repetition as that flows as well as in glass. Yeah. It was an experience, and I'm looking forward to my next one.
So my final question is, you described your work as being like children, and you talked about it in quite a personal way. Do you have a very personal relationship with your works as you make them, and how does that feel about, you know, you having to kind of let them go when they're purchased, or they go to their next lives?
The latter is difficult, but I think my very nomadic childhood and experience, early experience, also kind of reminded me that life can be temporal.
Yeah.
And that what you left for prosperity is as important. And I think what delights me is recalling and actually finding these people who have my work and seeing the work. And I think, oh my God, I made that. I think the past work tends to have much more resonance for me than what I'm making at present.
I can't believe it, Magdalene. We could all listen to you talk all evening, but we have sadly run out of time. So I'm going to hand back to Rosie Greenlees, who's going to say our thank yous. But very briefly, I've had a lot of questions asking about where people can read more about your work. And I do believe that the catalogue for the Journey of Things is still available via the Hepworth website. And so that's a good place to start, I think.
I think it's been reissued. The first was sold out, but I think they've republished it. So yes, you can get it.
Yeah. Thank you. Rosie, I'll hand that over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. What a fantastic talk, Magdalena. That was absolutely brilliant. And thank you so much, Gus, for facilitating it. It's been amazing. We've had over 1,000 people in this lecture.
Oh, you're kidding.
Phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. And so it's so exciting to see all those questions backing up. So it's been a great success. And I think, Magdalena, you spoke with great power as a witness of the damage of colonialism in your beginning of your life in Kenya. And I found that was very, very sobering. But I think what's so fantastic listening to you is the positive outcome of that experience in your work. And you talked about ceramics being life-changing and life-forming, and that sense of work being of life, and the description that you had of your objects as like cradling them, like babies, and pieces being living things. And I think what I take from that is looking at your work is really life enhancing, and that can only be a good thing, especially at the moment. So thank you so very, very much. It's been an absolutely pleasure to listen to you talk.
It's been a great honor and privilege, really.
Great. Well, thank you so much. And thank you all for coming tonight, and do continue to engage with Collect over the next few days. Thank you very much, and good night, everyone.